played well.
We do have one more semi-final to deal with, and that is the not insignificant matter of the Battle of the Wonder Kids here. George C versus Pavel, two very young challengers. George C, the most consistent man in this particular HCT season, showing up in his third HCT event now after two seasonal championships and now the last call. And Pavel, you know, working for his redemption story, really, after that catastrophic performance last time we saw him out here, but... playing a lot better today overall, I'd say.
Oh yeah, it was really impressive. Watching the Control Warrior mirror as well. Just playing that cartoon, shield slamming his own cartoon, then going for the Bran coin, yep. Doom color. Wow, just getting two more cartoons. A lot of those small decisions. Pavel is coming into this very well prepared.
Do you expect to see... we saw George C banning out Warrior in his previous series. Do you expect to see that continue? I mean... is just having that one freeze mage really a big enough deal to mean that you're forced to just leave a power deck like Shaman up for the whole tournament?
Yeah, only if George C is 100% sure that his mage is getting banned, he will leave the Warrior up.
Okay.
But I would expect him to be banning the Warrior every time here.
Mm-hmm. And from Pavel's side, what's his big fear point in George C's lineup, do you think?
I mean, he might be scared of the mage, honestly. Like, if he knows that his warrior is going out, that might be a problem. Like, freeze mage is something that has been a little bit looked at as if it is a weak spot in many lineups. But we have seen many players do so well with it lately. So, I don't know. Like, it might be scary.
What's the reason, specifically, if you outline for the viewers, why freeze mage has suddenly come back into such prominence? Because it wasn't really a deck that you ever saw on ladder, very, very rarely in tournaments. Now it seems like it's almost like a 50-50 shot to see if people are bringing it to tournaments, and it's even scattered around the ladder meta as well now.
Well, one huge thing that I personally consider to be a big deal is that the shamans tended to be running Doomhammers, and Doomhammer is 16 damage, and your Alexstrasza will be too late. So now that most shamans, and actually every single shaman here, is running Spirit Claws as their weapon of choice over the Doomhammer, I think that makes the Shaman matchup much better. So you can't ban both Aggro Shaman and Control Warrior. There's two matchups. Right. So if there's no Aggro Shaman, I guess you only have the Warrior to worry about.
Fair enough. So they see George C's route there very quickly. You see huge chunks of ladder points from both of these players, but George C in particular hasn't messed around with open cups whatsoever. He's just sitting there saying, I'll leave that to you guys. I'm just going to finish top 10 on ladder every season and do it that way. And Pavel as well, massive green chunk on his wheel there of ladder finishes, but still some open cups picked up for him.
Yeah, I feel like whenever I queue into Pavel on the ladder, he's always very high ranked, and I'm not surprised. He does play very well.
Yeah, I remember back in the day, almost like over a year ago at this point, when Priest was a playable Hearthstone class, believe it or not, I would always see Pavel hanging around rank 1 legend on my friends list and would go to spectate, and he's just jamming Priest at rank 1, like queuing at rank 1 and winning games with Priest. Like, he is an absolute ladder animal. But George C as well, I think, was getting into top 100 legend when he was 13 years old or something ridiculous like that. Like, what were you doing when you were 13, Savitz?
Well, not ranking very high on the ladder, that's for sure. But about Pavel, I just wanted to point out another thing. He's like a very much a control player, and I enjoy his style. Like, just bringing those like greedy type of decks and combo decks. He can play anything. If this was a 9-class format, Pavel would be still doing awesome. Like, he can play anything. Like, even Priest that you mentioned.
Yep, yes indeed. But outside of the C'Thun Warrior that he's brought, which obviously has a great matchup against the Freeze Mage, the other greedy decks that he has, are they going to match up well against what George C has?
I think so. I think it's going to be very evenly matched with the lineups that these guys are bringing. It might be have a little bit to do with how do they line up against each other. For example, like, what is the rogues going to be playing against? Like, whose rogue is playing against what? Because rogue has a little bit of like a polarized matchup. So that might be a big thing.
Certainly might. Well, I can't wait. We have one grand finalist. Let's find out who the other one is going to be, whether it's going to be George C or Pavel. Ready to find out with us are Raven and Firebat.
Thanks a lot, guys. Yeah, we are here ready for the second semi-final, and this is going to decide who is going to face RDU in the grand finals of the day. And this is, as the guys were saying, pretty crazy matchup, sort of as Sol said, the Battle of the Wonder Kids to a certain extent. Both relatively young players, but both performing extremely well. And we can see there the bans have just popped up, and it is going to be Pavel's Warrior ban. Not too much of a surprise overall, but the Rogue ban from George C. What do you make of this?
That makes a lot of sense with Pavel's lineup having so many, slow control decks. Just getting that Rogue out of the way. It's a deck that typically, farms slow control decks. Makes a lot of sense for the lineup.
Yeah, and this is what happens when you build your lineup in a slightly different style than just bringing the most solid sort of general ladder decks. When you build it in a very sort of control heavy style like Pavel's done, it means that your ban strategies are normally very different as opposed to usual ban shaming out. But we are getting into the first game. It's going to be George C on the Hunter versus Pavel on the Druid.
Yeah, typically speaking, Druid's going to have an edge in this matchup. You know, they're just really good at controlling the board. They have such great removal to stop Hunter's threats and can oftentimes get ahead on the board early, you know, ramping the mana. It used to be kind of scary because of the power level of Hymane and the power level of Call of the Wild on 8, but now Call of the Wild doesn't come out until 9, and Hymane, it usually isn't too big of a deal just because you can oftentimes establish a big enough board as Druid or ramp ahead enough in mana with things like Wild Growth and Nourish in conjunction with each other.
Yeah, I think one of the big differences as well is in the matchup, as the Hunter at least, I used to be happy with putting on early pressure, then guarantee some burn to end the game. But with players bringing Feral Rage or Feral Rage and then Moonglade Portal or you know things from Raven Idols as well, suddenly you can't really rely on that strategy because they just boost themselves back out of range. And with no board after that, there's just not a lot you can do as the Hunter. Even a Call of the Wild won't be enough.
And taunts can oftentimes get in the way. We see you know, a little bit of a different kind of strategy for Pavel here. He doesn't have Ancient of Wars in his deck, and he instead has Dark Arakoa. So a little bit more flexible of a taunt can come down a little bit earlier, and maybe can come down with other minions on the board to avoid, you know, Deadly Shot situations. And it's not as big of an investment into Deadly Shot.
Yeah, it's not too bad at all, just getting that taunt out a little bit earlier. But you've got to see Pavel just start to do the usual, the grand plan for the Druid here is stop Hunter hitting you in the face and really reduce
cards.
The board down. Yeah, and as you said, going into the Nourish next turn, he has two Azure Drakes and the second Wrath to be able to just deal with anything that comes out here. So I feel like Pavel's in a really strong position, although with double Houndmaster, Jodzi's going to really want to hope this fiery bat lives.
Yeah, you may even consider just not even playing it. You know, we see him thinking about it here, picking it up, putting it back down, kind of signaling to Pavel that he's thinking about something. So Pavel could kind of make a read on this once he sees if it comes out, if it is a fiery bat, you know, maybe George C has a Houndmaster in his hand, kind of giving that away a little bit. And, yeah, that kind of hesitation can really cost you in some of these situations because he's thinking about saving it for next turn where he can play Fiery Bat and Houndmaster at the same time to kind of guarantee the buff. And he doesn't end up just playing it out there. Turn 5 is a very populated turn from Druid. They have things like Nourish and Azure Drake and sometimes even Druid of the Claw. We know in Pavel's deck right now, just Nourish and Azure Drake on that slot, but still 4 cards on that slot. I would really like to see Pavel go with Nourish for crystals here and just, you know, cycle the Wrath on the Fiery Bat or use a hero power on the Fiery Bat to get rid of it. You know, George C kind of gave away some information there with that hesitation and the picking it up and putting it back down. And with 2 Azure Drakes in your hand, you have the ability to kind of reload after the fact. So it's just so powerful to get the crystals and start pushing out that early mana lead.
Yeah, and if you can get ahead whilst keeping the Hunter board relatively low, which is, you know, he's done a really good job. You know, he's only on 26, that, you know, well, 25 after the bat, of course, but, you know, going into turn 4, only being on 25 and only having the Squire on the board, you're feeling pretty good as the Druid when you're moving up into an 8 mana turn to follow up. And now, with that Wolf coming down, he has the opportunity to just Wrath into Swipe if he really wants to clear it up and then just force the reduction down onto the board state for George C. But he also just has the Drake to actually just put a minion on the board and just start battling for it in a, you know, a minion fight as opposed to just using up all the resources from the spells.
Yeah, he still has to be conscious about that Houndmaster. Definitely is something in the back of his mind, the threat of it for sure, and may see him react to it here with maybe a Living Roots on the Infested Wolf and a hero power down, one of the 1/1s. Or you may see him just ignore it, I guess, and
yeah, I think he's just going to take his time because one of the benefits he does have next turn is the second there's your Drake into Swipe, which is going to be able to deal with the at least, you know, the Houndmastered Wolf if it comes to it. But also, even Houndmaster on this turn isn't too great for George in terms of just the Hunter playing towards its mana curve, right?
I mean, it's slightly off and it slows him down. You can fill it up with the Knife Juggler here. So we can go Knife Juggler, Coin Houndmaster, take the value trade. So it sets himself in a little bit better position against Swipe. But then Pavel's going to be able to react with, you know, Swipe plus Wrath plus Hero Power and be totally fine with that. Pump up actually a really big Yogg if he wants it to as well. And, you know, still just has card draw to refill his hand. The Wrath will be drawing a card that turn. The Azure Drake can also draw a card. So just so much cycle, so much removal. And just being 4 mana ahead of your opponent.
Yeah, it's
absolutely
insane.
Nuts. Yeah, it's just Druid can get off to these disgusting starts, and they oftentimes win against other mid-range decks simply because they have more mana and better removal than some of the other
mid-range
decks.
They can just do more stuff than you can. most turns. So we are going to see the trade go into there, try and get the juggle.
This is an interesting play by George C to try and help himself play around those sort of swipe scenarios. Now he's got more minions at staggered health totals. If he would have just, you know, Houndmastered up the Infested Wolf, it would have been left at one health, making him extremely vulnerable to swipe plus hero power or swipe plus wrath. But in this way, he's able to kind of avoid a lot of the potential swipe scenarios. It's a really good play.
Yeah, and Pavel's in a position where he can still do a really good job of clearing most of the board out, at least.
Yeah.
And, you know, as you mentioned, he does have the backup plan of, because he's just used so many spells already, the worst case scenario, if he really needs something wacky to happen, he could just drop Yogg and then just hope for the best. So a really good backup plan for him, at least. But with the Fandral Staghelm, probably the most singular powerful card in the Druid deck for the potential it can have, is going to be drawn, so it's given a few more options in terms of using the Wrath and the Living Roots to clear up some of the board and then holding on to Azurdrake Swipe.
I think you might want to be considering holding on to Azurdrake Swipe simply because George C is going into the 6-mana turn, and your
what
biggest
happens
fear
on 6-mana against Hunter Fiber?
it's the high main turn, so you really want to have something left in play after the fact. So Pavel, his mindset right now isn't how do I clear the board the best, because he had full clear options. His mindset is how do I make sure my opponent cannot play Savannah Highmane.
Yep.
And that's why he set up this awkward situation for George C, where, you know, if George C has a removal spell, it's really great for him. He's able to kind of clear off the Azurdrake and keep on trucking, but that means he is unable to play Savannah Highmane. And that's priority number one for Pavel, since he doesn't have a great toolkit for answering it at the moment, is just make sure George C has to use a removal spell. Even if he gets a little bit of value out of the removal spell, you don't care. You have your advantage that can start snowballing. You just need to delay Savannah Highmane for just one more turn so you can really get your footing back on the board.
Yeah, and now he does have the option of just going Animal Companion Kill Command if he really wants. I feel like because the board isn't really flooded at all on Pavel's side, that Deadly Shot is very valuable to take down, say, an Arakoa, for example. So I really like this. See what the Animal Companion is first, because if it is a Huffer or Leoc, he could actually just choose to hold on to the Kill Command and use the minion to trade.
Yeah, the one reason I really like using the minion to trade is you get so much value out of it, right? Like, Pavel has so much extra mana to be able to utilize his hero power, but George C is going to disagree here and just go in, push a little extra damage this way, and aggressive.
If he has to hero power it, right, it's an additional 4 damage, or like, you know, 3, because you gain the armor anyway. So I don't mind that play at all from George, using the kill command to just keep the minion on the board. Do you see Fandral come down now and that sweet, sweet Wrath value clearing up the Leoc with no problems whatsoever, as well as drawing a card.
Yeah, and
pretty strong turn when the Hunter's on 2 cards.
Yeah, now Pavel's secured a very large board. So even if there was a high main from George C's side, you know, you can see how delaying it for a turn allows Pavel to set up for the ability to answer it the following turn, because he's able to milk his mana advantage for just another turn, which allows him to get just that much far ahead on board.
Is this just a prep for Yogg? He just innovated out hero power. Now, why would you do that if you weren't going to Yogg? Because it's not under really any health threat for a star. And also, it's not turn 9. So it's not like he's wants all the health or wants to just weave in extra damage to set up lethal or avoid the Call of the Wild shenanigans.
I think it is mainly for Yogg. The Innervate's not doing a lot in his hand right now, and being able to hero power every turn could be extremely relevant. Being able to push a little bit of extra damage, being able to gain a little bit of extra life. He saw George C go for that kill command play on his Azurdrake to push damage with a 4-1, which is extremely aggressive. Like, it's a very aggressive line of play. It uses resources pretty frivolously, and Pavel's most likely reading into that, being like, all right, my opponent's got damage in his hand. He's setting up for something evil here. So yeah, that's
something
why he's kind of
evil.
That's why he's kind of like
he's evil because he wants to win the game.
Yeah, that's why he's kind of like taking that extra defensive line, innervating out the hero power, I believe. George C has a curve here. He can fill out his hand with the Unleash the Hounds plus the Houndmaster, and
I think he almost has to, because otherwise the Houndmaster is very, very dead in hand after.
Yeah.
You know, the odds when you continue to draw beasts you can get value from is quite low. We're going to see the trade by the looks of things. Just going to a quick value trade there, taking down the 2-2, leaving the dog alive as a taunt as well. And he's already seen a Wrath. He's seen 2 Wrath swipes. He's seen a lot of like the easy removal for this. But there's going to be a Living Roots with Fandral, so it's going to spawn 2 of the saplings. And look, this is just the power of Fandral living, basically.
Yeah,
so many cards you're going to draw are going to get the double value. And that's, I'll just kill off that, spawn 2 1-1s. 4 attack, 8 armor, and just keep going. And as you said, this is just continuing to fuel Yogg, if he even needs it.
Yeah, at the moment, he really doesn't need it, but he's going to have it ready in hand just in case Call of the Wild comes out. That's really the big trigger for it. And, you know, Fiery Bat, not the card you want to draw here. It's
Just going for the deadly shot to kill Fandral.
Yeah, and desperation plays here. He's able to take out the 3-2, which removes just as much attack power off the board as removing Fandral would. Only five cards remaining in the deck could even combo with Fandral.
Yeah, this just looks like it's going to close the game out. George C just couldn't get on the board early enough and fast enough.
He was on the board.
Yeah, he couldn't stay on the board.
The problem was staying on the board. Yeah. So he was able to get on the board, you know, because Pavel has to originally surrender the board to be able to ramp up in mana.
Yeah.
But then Druid has so many great removal tools that they're able to use that extra mana that they've gained to take back the board while cycling cards, which is what makes them so devastatingly strong.
Yeah. And see the invisible Ragnaros OP.
Whoa.
That did look like it hit twice, but it in fact only hit once.
Now that's a game changer card right there. Now we're off to the races. Something interesting could happen this game for sure, and it's going to be interesting how Pavel wants to play it. Looks like he's going off to the races.
Ooh.
So the Ragnaros could end the game. Unless he chooses here to, you know, swipe it and remove it, which I would like to see from him.
Yeah, you have an 8-8, right? Yeah, what's the problem?
You set up lethal either way.
And you've seen a deadly shot, so it's going to be fine regardless.
Yeah, and you have the 1-1. It's 50-50 on the deadly shot. So, yeah, I really like removing it from Pavel's side. He needs Call of the Wild now to really stay in it for George C. And Invisible Call of the Wild would be just a clutch pickup.
Yeah, although can you attack the Misha if it's
quick
invisible?
Shot. Quick shot into quick shot into...
something.
Misha keeps him alive.
Mm.
Okay. And, you know, if he just has a few more turns to get there. And this is where you can see the Innervate Hero Power from Pavel really paying off. 5 turns in advance, he Innervated Hero Power and has Hero Powered every turn since. And it's making a very dramatic difference.
Yeah, I imagine we're just going to see Hero Power pass here, as there's not many, just one card. It would literally need to be quick shot into... because he doesn't even have Animal Companion left for another Misha at this point.
Well, Bow would be pretty good. Quick shot into Bow.
That would work. Ardent Squire is not good, though, and that is going to be game, as Pavel takes the first in the series versus George C. with the Druid deck. And I think from a very early stage in that game, that was a pretty rough one for George C. Did have the chance towards the end, because he did push Pavel quite low, but just having that Fandral on the board for so long was just so much value, and then having the Yogg as a backup plan.
Yeah, the real highlight there was, you know, Pavel had the you know, really good Druid hand, you know, Wild Growth on 2, Nourish on 5 with the Azurdrakes to refill his hand. So he had the nuts hand, right?
Yep.
And then the way he piloted it, though, the important part there is he set up for the high main, and even if George C. had the response, you know, best Hunter hand, Pavel set himself up in a situation so that he would be able to deal with that. And that's really important to note, because oftentimes you look at these games and say, you know, the Druid just drew the nuts and ran away with it. But it's also setting yourself up in situations where you can get the most out of your cards, and that's what Pavel did there. So pretty impressive play.
Yeah, really strong play overall from Pavel, but we will be back shortly to continue the series. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back, everyone, to the second semi-final of the day. It is Pavel versus George C, and Pavel is 1-0 ahead with a very confident first game for him. So off to a great start. Must feel fantastic, because this is the game where if you win, you go into the finals to have to win one more series to book a spot in BlizzCon.
Yeah, it's do or die. Single elimination. You got to win it all. So both players, you know, really gunning for it. Pavel looking for redemption from his... 2015 run where he got so close to making it but just didn't quite make it to BlizzCon, looking to capitalize on it this time. And George C, you know, just a few weeks ago was one game away from making it to BlizzCon, so he also looking to try and book his ticket there finally. So a lot on the line for these players.
Yeah, and George C just even just repeat performances, you know, spring and summer back to back, getting into the top 8, which is an incredible feat as it is. And then on top of that, obviously those finishes help boost him into the top 8 points earners of the year so far, which is why he's here in this tournament and so far doing pretty well, except in this series where he's 0-1 down. And you know, it is only game one. This is best of 7, of course, so there's a long way to go yet. It's not like he's down and out already, but that was a pretty rough loss in the fact that it was just so one-sided from early on.
Sometimes Druid gets those kind of hands where you can't really do much about it, but, you know, George C., he fought back. You know, he had some really cool plays. I really liked the play where he popped the infested wolf and then Houndmastered after the fact to play around, you know, swipe plus wrath plus hero power. That was a pretty good play. So, you know, he's on his game. He's on point. He's fired up. His hair looks great. He's ready to go.
Yeah, and we are getting into the second game of this series, Pavel versus George C. Pavel is 1-0 up. It's going to be Pavel on the Tempo Mage versus George C's Shaman, which is the mid-range variant, because no one plays aggro anymore.
Yeah, the Rock Biter's gone, and so is the aggro. But Tempo Mage, not a deck we've seen too much in the tournament thus far, and quite an interesting deck.
Yeah, especially there's a few ways this can be built as well. We saw, you know, the power of the Cabalist Tome list when Dr. Tippy recently won with that. But Pavel's actually gone for a different variant. He's gone for the two summoners as well, which is interesting.
He's gone the full tempo. He's not even he doesn't have as much value in it as much so as he has minions. Like, a lot of tempo mages cut water elemental and they run, you know, either one or zero faceless summoners. He's got double water elemental, double faceless summoner. He's looking to just play minions on curve and smack people in the face. It's a very aggressive sort of approach to tempo mage, and even tops it off with a Ragnaros at the top end.
Yeah, just taking a large selection of really solid minions. Like, it continues to surprise me when I see some tempo mage lists where water elemental doesn't make the cut, because I feel like just the card itself is just so powerful in general, especially with how dominant weapon classes are at the moment. You can just lock weapon classes out pretty hard with that card. But
Shaman is a weapon class that's very, very popular. All eight players playing it.
I've heard that is a popular class.
Warrior is very popular in the tournament as well, and even Rogue on the rise of popularity. So yeah, a lot of the classes people bringing have weapons, and it's a pretty good call.
If you run into the Pirate Warrior sometimes.
Even the Pirate Warrior. So a pretty aggressive approach here by Pavel, coining out the summoner here. It's a risk. Like, a lot of times you can get blown out of the water by even just a Totem Golem buffing the Tunnel Trog to be able to trade up, and he's rewarded for this risk. You saw him
massively
debating it. You know, he's thinking about potentially holding back on it, but does end up going for it, and it's absolutely huge here. And now he's going to be able to develop the Cult Sorcerer and maybe even Arcane Missiles down the opponent's minion if he wants to.
Yeah, I like it, because if you get the missiles and kill off the Thanos, it means the Sorceress is just slightly more safe, which means your next turn, no matter what your opponent plays, you're going to Flame Waker and just do like ridiculous things with the Arcane Blast and just get so much more value combined with the spell power as well. And just set up a really strong board that George C is probably going to struggle to deal with.
Yeah, and I like getting the Cult Sorcerer on the field, especially since it's unlikely for your opponent to have Maelstrom Portal at this point, because they did just kind of drop the Thalnos out there. The one thing you really got to worry about is Storm. Tempo Mage, not really minion dense a lot of the times, and, you know, even though Pavel's version is a little bit more minion dense than other versions, still getting blown out by a Storm here can be really detrimental to your progress forward in the match if you just top deck spells. And wow, all four missiles went to the face there, and now he's forced to, you know, kind of waste resources here. He has to use the Arcane Blast to try and protect his Sorcerer's Apprentice.
That was so unlikely to happen. Those missiles just wanted to go face and go aggressive. They should have been in a Hunter deck, in my opinion. But it's not completely terrible for Pavel. He did have the backup option. It wasn't great that he had to use it, of course. He would have much preferred to use it with the Flame Waker next turn, or even just later on in general, so you normally get the spell power value. But having the backup mean he could still clear the board.
Yeah, I mean, imagine in a world where he didn't have to use it, he'd just play Flame Waker here and then Arcane Blast the Totem Golem.
He would just win.
Yeah, but still, you know, the backup plan, not too bad. Arcane Intellect coming off the top to kind of fill out his curve here. He's still got the Frostbolt to be able to clear the Totem Golem if he wants. He could potentially save the Frostbolt for face damage, but I like just using it here to fill out the curve and, you know, being able to fill in Arcane Blast with the Flame Waker just in case your Sorcerer's Apprentice dies and you kind of clunks up your turn for the next one.
Yeah, I agree. The flexibility of the Arcane Blast feels better to save, especially because even if there's not a great target for it next turn, the power of that combined with any spell damage minion is huge. You just one mana deal 4 damage is incredible.
It's such a good tempo swing, and, you know, tempo swing's pretty good in Tempo Mage.
Yeah, that seems correct. So, this is an interesting one here. I just... Frostbolt is can be kind of great later on, maybe even to stall out the Spirit Claws, but this just feels too clean. And you know, Pavel did end up going for it, and I like that he's taking his time. There's no rush, apart from the turn timer in general, which, you know, everyone's used to, but there's no rush to, you know, really go out for a quick play. Just can fully think about every single turn. As we said, you know, if you win this game, you win this match, you go on to the finals, which is huge.
Yeah. Tempo Mage, such a great deck for right now. Like, it's so many players are teching in Harrison Jones and all of their decks to kind of help deal with Shaman. You know, they have it in the Druids, they have it in their own Shamans, and, you know, a lot of decks are getting kind of greedier to deal with the greed of the Warriors. A lot of people are playing Hunter, and Tempo Mage kind of just really punishes people that are a little too greedy, especially aggressive variants of the Temple Mage, and that's what we're seeing happen right now. As
yeah, and look at this, I love it.
Do so much damage.
This is the power of Flame Waker when you can weave in some spells. And this Apprentice, MVP, been on the board forever. And this is just game over for Judge Seok, because we can see that maybe not next turn, but at worst the turn after, he can just Phylan's Pulse straight through the Shaman's face. And then, yeah, there we go. There's the self-lightning ball. This is a common theme with Judge Seok. He pinged his own face in a Freeze Mage game earlier on today, just to end that match he knows he's going to lose. So that was quick.
Yeah, that was really quick. And, you know, Tempo Mage can do that sometimes. Yep. We didn't even see a busted Tempo Mage start. Like, you talk about crazy Tempo Mage starts, you're like, Mana Worm, coin Mana Worm into stuff. But, you know, this start for Pavel was just good enough to take it, just because George C's Shaman deck is, like most of the other Shaman decks, not teched to deal with Tempo Mage. I don't think anybody really expected Tempo Mage. Pavel, I think, is the only guy bringing Tempo Mage, and it's caught everybody off guard so far, just sneaking wins in there against all the greedy decks.
I think the importance as well is George C didn't have access to a Claws or a Lightning Bolt early on, because if that Apprentice died, then the whole game would have looked a lot slower, because he wouldn't have been able to do the missiles and the blast for zero mana that turn that really helped him just clear out the board and then continue to build on that. So getting the Apprentice down in that very aggressive way, because he coined it out as well.
Yeah, it's a big risk.
But it paid off.
Yeah, you can see what happens when it works out. When it doesn't work out, it's a different story. But when it works out, holy smokes, does it work out.
Yeah, and there's going to be no messing about here. We're going straight into game three. Pavel going for his Shaman now, and George C on his Freeze Mage. So a matchup that's, you know, as the guys did a great explanation of earlier on, Salt and Savitz, with this matchup has flipped to a certain extent, and it used to be terrible for the Mage because of mainly everyone was playing aggro Shaman, and you was used Doomhammer to great effect to just pile on so much damage. But now it's much more manageable and kind of George C's speciality deck to a large extent. So going on to a comfort pick, and I think he's going to be feeling pretty good about the way this one's going to go.
Yeah, definitely in George C's favor now because of the loss of things like Doomhammer from the Shaman deck. But the Shaman decks have had the addition of Ragnaros to try and salvage this matchup a little bit. And we haven't seen any of the Shamans really been able to use it to their full extent.
It's because they've not been bonzing it out.
Yeah,
that's the trick.
That's the trick. So the Shamans have just felt like too slow to be able to finish the game. They just don't quite get the board built up and able to connect enough damage fast enough. So it's typically going to go in the favor of the Freeze Mage player. But every now and again, Shaman's able to sneak a win out just because.
Just because.
It's Shaman, man. Yeah. They're able to do incredible things.
When you're on the desk with me, Firebat.
Shaman.
Okay, well, looking at George C's hand, we'll get there one day. Looking at George C's hand, it is quite well-rounded, I would say, as well. There's a lot of burn slash removal he can use. He does have the Blizzard for a little bit later on, and now a Frost Nova as well, combined with the card draw potential from the Acolyte as well. So pretty well-rounded, not really missing out on too much. Does have the Ice Barrier to stall for the secret later on. So
talking about well-rounded hands, though, Pavel's able to go Totem Golem into Totem Golem into Manatide Totem. And
it's pretty good curve.
That's about as much heat as you can possibly put on as the mid-range Shaman in the early game. So doing a really good job at, you know, pressuring while also, you know, refilling his hand and getting close to that Ragnaros. You know, you're expecting Manatide to continue drawing cards. Azurdrake's going to cycle a card. You're just increasing the percent chance that you have that Ragnaros on 8. And when you drop Ragnaros on 8, you got a pretty good shot at actually winning the match.
Yeah, and here's my key question.
Okay.
Is this Manatide worth a Frostbolt this turn? Because it's such a difficult... We've discussed Manatide at length today, and that on one hand, you have Totem Golem. It's going to keep whacking you in the face for 3. But on the other hand, you have a 0-3 minion that it feels awkward to kill because it's not directly damaging you, but it is killing you to a certain extent of just really ramping up the card draw.
I think it is not worth killing. I think it's important to ignore. I think you want to be doing your own game plan as the Freeze Mage. If you're able to line up your freezes, one Ragshot or even 2 Ragshots probably won't even matter if your card draw is able to go as fluidly as, you know, Freeze Mage anticipates their card draw to be able to go. So I think it's very important just to stick to your game plan, and if you can execute your game plan first, you're going to win. So I don't think you even need to respect the Shaman player's game plan very much at all.
Cool. So looks like Pavel is going to clear up the Acolyte. No need to give the Freeze Mage an additional card draw at all. Yep. Especially he's going to continue to cash in on that Manatide totem and just get the Drake down as well. The fortunate thing for Pavel to a certain extent is double Lightning Storm in hand. They would probably like to be at the bottom of the deck if he could choose.
For sure.
And they could be any other two cards in the deck as well. But it's not doing too bad so far. He does have the Thunder Bluff as well for a little bit later on when he's built up more of a board and that instant pressure and instant damage, more importantly.
So George C. doesn't have very great options in his hand. You can think about Frost Nova, but I really don't like Frost Noving. You know, generally the rule is like anything under about 8 damage isn't worth Frost Noving. So I'd kind of like to see him just maybe go for the Novice Engineer and the Barrier. You can think about kind of using some of your burn on potentially removing maybe that Totem Golem and maybe go with like the Roaring Torch plus the Novice Engineer.
Yeah, I think what we're pretty sure of is we're not going to see the Tempo Kobold play.
It's
not going to be too good against this board at least. It's going to cycle, though.
Sure.
Got a Torch, going to clear up the Totem Golem. Yeah. Nothing too flashy, but it's going to help George get towards the card draw he really needs and get the job done in the long run.
Yeah, and I expect Pavel's just going to be trying to push as much damage as fast as possible. So we do see the Flame Tongue come out, and I'd likely we're going to see this Spirit Claws come out and just ignore the Novice Engineer and just everything swing right at the dome.
Yeah, this is going to be a hell of a lot of damage coming up. Spirit Claws and the three duration, or durability, should I say, on the Spirit Claws is like so crazy. Trade. Yeah. What is he afraid of with the
Blizzard
the one damage?
Plus trade in can kill your Manatide or your Flame Tongue Totem, so I guess that's some sort of concern. But three damage is a lot of damage against Freeze Mage.
Yeah, but yeah, as I was saying, the durability on the Spirit Claws is huge. Like, three is actually such a big number when it can effectively be a three-swing Fiery War Axe when you've got this kind of guaranteed spell power that Pavel has.
For sure, for sure. The only distinction is the time, because if the Freeze Mage is able to get an Ice Block down, and then you don't pop the Ice Block, and they Alexstrasza you,
you're dead.
You're dead, yeah. So you're really on a race against the clock, and you're really hoping that Alexstrasza and those Ice Blocks are real buried deep in their deck, and they're unable to kind of make that happen. And for George C. at the moment, that kind of is the case. He's looking at, you know, possibly having to, if he wants to continue cycling, go with, like, Loot Horde or Frost Nova, or if he doesn't want to go continue cycling and just get the freeze out, he could go with the clunkier freeze and just drop a Blizzard here, but either way, it's nothing too pretty this turn, and I lean more towards just the Blizzard, but I could understand also going for some other line of play.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind.
Not even going for a freeze on the board. No, that makes a lot of sense, right?
Just he reduces the damage down by 4 anyway.
Sure, yeah.
But yeah, I wouldn't have minded the Blizzard purely because the way I approach his Blizzard is like super awkward to get off on a good turn. So if you just Blizzard on 6, fine, and then that opens up the Frost Nova later on to squeeze in more impactful turns.
The issue with George C's play here is he left all these totems out on the field going into the turn 7 from Pavel. Perfect turn for him to actually get value out of Thunderbluff Valiant and actually push damage with it. So that could end up kind of hurting him as he is getting towards a really low life total. And now you got to start worrying about, is Rag just going to snipe me and kill me? Like, that's a real thing that can start happening. And you got to worry about lightning bolts as well with double spell power present on the board. If you're not actually clearing the board and you're just freezing it, 5 damage lightning bolts, nothing to joke about. Double lightning bolt plus the spirit claws would be lethal.
Yeah, and the fear of this kind of damage coming out from nowhere is actually very real, purely because that Manatide has been on the board forever.
That's drawn a lot of cards.
Your opponent's been drawing 2 cards a turn. That's just unfair.
Yeah, it's looking real shaky for George C. He's not at the prettiest of life totals. Typically speaking, you want to be a little bit higher. You never want to get yourself around that 8 life. That's the scary part. So trying to minimize the amount of damage prior to this to try and make sure you stay at around, you know, like 18-ish is usually pretty good, so they can't just poke you with
the problem is
blows.
Now George C is kind of like weighing up Blizzard, but he could have just done that last turn, and then he would have had way more options, or at least more options that this turn to work in with a Frost Nova, a second Blizzard even. And yeah, he's been pushed into the Blizzard slightly off curve, and whenever the Freeze Mage can't utilize the whole turn's worth of mana, you're in a bad spot, because you really need to use everything you've got to be able to put together that very specific win condition.
Yeah, it is usually pretty rare that Freeze Mage has to hang a mana. Typically speaking, they plan all their turns out in advance to try and make sure they never hang a mana.
You even like see stuff like Coin Ping just to fill out
just
the curve,
every
right?
time, usually, Freeze Mage. And there's that Ragnaros finally found for Pavel.
Well,
and he has George C. in a position where he can, you know, pop the block directly out of hand.
And when you draw a million cards a turn, it was only a matter of time to see Ragnaros.
Yeah, and you know, it comes down to that taking extra 4 damage for George C here, and that's what's going to allow the Ragnaros to be able to get the guaranteed pop. So he's going to go Blizzard and maybe a Loot Hoarder on top of it. He might even think about, you know, Frostbolting the face to stop the Spirit Claw's damage coming in. But Lightning Bolt plus Ragnaros is going to end him.
Yeah, this is where Freeze Mage gets extremely difficult to play, and why it's such a sort of high skill cap deck is that at this point, George C will be thinking, exactly what do I need to do and what needs to happen for me to win this game, because I'm in such a rough position. And, you know, George C's proven in the past that he can actually identify those outs very quickly and build his whole game plan around it. But we can see that there's potentially just all the damage in the world available here. It's going to be a guaranteed proc because he can kill off the Loot Hoarder with the Spirit Claws and with Rag on the board. Plus, the board's full as well. The Thunderbluff's still there to buff the totems.
Now, imagine George C's 4 health higher here and the Ice Block doesn't get popped.
And the Rag hits the Loot Hoarder.
Yeah, well, I mean, if the Rag hits him in the face, or the Rag hits the 50-50 for the Loot Hoarder. And if it hits the 50-50 for the Loot Hoarder and George C's Ice Block doesn't get popped and he top decks Alexstrasza here, then he has a reasonable chance, and then he would just win the game. So halfway through his deck had about, 50% chance to find the Alexstrasza by that point. So
yep, and there it is. It's going to be Pavel going up 3-0 versus George C. This is going to be an incredible performance if he can actually close it out 4-0.
Yeah, I mean, you got to kind of credit that to Pavel's draws there in the beginning. You know, the best possible thing mid-range Shaman can do against Freeze Mage is go Totem Golem into Manatide, and that's what Pavel did. So he was able to just draw 2 cards a turn for the entire game. The Freeze Mage can't really afford to commit resources to answering the Manatide Totem. They just kind of try and do their game plan. And then that opening there, leaving up 2 totems going into turn 7, allowed Pavel to push just enough damage to get it so that George C, with the help of the Spirit Claws from Pavel, to be in Ragnaros range going into turns 8 and 9. And you can't be in that position as the Freeze Mage. You just get popped too early. So, you know, maybe a little bit of a mistake there letting that happen, or a calculated risk one way or the other.
Yeah, it's definitely a rough game for George C there. But we will see if Pavel can continue this incredible performance and close out the series right after this. Welcome back, everyone, to what is potentially the last game of this series, and we are only 3 games in. Pavel already 3-0 up over George C in the second semi-finals of the day. An incredible performance so far, and like I said, he's just got to get 1 win with Rogue against any of George C's classes to take this out and move on to the grand finals to face RDU.
Yeah, and typically speaking, Rogue's pretty okay against Druid. Not anything special, but like okay. And it's all right against Hunter. Maybe a little bit better than all right, slightly favored, if you will. And then it's maybe slightly favored against Shaman as well. A little less favored than it is against Hunter. And then just atrocious against Freeze Mage, though. But, you know, it's got a few good matchups in the midst. And we're going to start off with the one bad matchup for Rogue. So most likely Pavel not going to be taking this one. And George C will kind of get himself on the board and start trying to get back on the reverse sweep train. But hopefully Pavel, you know, doesn't get too shooken up by it, realize it's a bad matchup, maybe takes a little bit of extra risks since it's a bad matchup. And
don't be so negative, Fireby. The game's not over yet. It's only just started. Come on.
You have to have that sort of mindset when you get into a bad matchup. It's like, I need to take a little bit of extra risks. I know that the win rates in this matchup are like 70-30 in favor of the Freeze Mage. If I have the ability to make a big Edwin and YOLO it, let's YOLO it. Let's go ham.
Yeah, I completely agree. And talking of risk, Servant of Yogg-Saron is in hand. And you know what? The only time I've ever played that card, it Starfalled itself. So I paid 5 mana to pass a turn, and it felt very bad. So I've never touched that card since. But we'll see if Pavel has a little bit better luck. It can do incredible things, to be fair. So it could be a huge impact. And as you said, maybe not a decided risk by Pavel to get in this card, of course. He did get it from the Swashburglar. But this could be this could be something that can actually get him ahead somehow. Mm-hmm. So we'll see how it pans out. George C just doing the usual Freeze Mage things of playing Acolyte and drawing cards.
So, yeah, maybe you just save it for Flare. Can it cast Flare?
No, it's 5 mana.
Oh, only 5 mana. Yeah. I don't even know the card.
Yeah, don't play it. I don't recommend it. I've not had a good win rate with that card of my 1 game, 1 loss.
Sure. So maybe it gets a Nourish, though. Just ramps you up in mana. Just takes the game by storm. You just turn into that Rogue Druid hybrid.
I hope he just slams it on five. Just to be like, you know what, I've got it. Let's see what you can do. He has a lot of games to be able to take one win. Oh, it's five or less. You can.
I knew what I was talking about.
Dude, no, don't give me that.
Come
right.
On,
you had
man.
No clue.
I knew.
You had
what
no
I was
clue. The second
about.
I said it's five, man, you just believed me.
Well,
so.
Because I don't want to make you look bad.
Guys,
I'm a nice guy.
Guys at home, don't listen to Fiber.
I'm a nice guy.
He acts like he knows what he's talking about, but it's all a facade.
He's going to cast Flare with that later on in the match. That's going to happen
okay.
now.
We'll see.
The caster curse exists, man. I've said it's going to happen, and now it will. So I'm excited for that.
Okay, well, now I've shown off my lack of knowledge of certain cards. Like I said, I played it the once and was done, so that's my excuse. George C. is... What does he have available?
He's got the ability to play, you know, one of these ice blocks out. You kind of have to get it out at some point. And then he can also, behind this, just play a Doomsayer Install for a turn or play a Novice Engineer to begin cycling.
What spell could he use from Yogg's minion of Yogg-Saron's servant, sorry, to clear the Doomsayer?
There's a lot of options. Shadow Word Pain, for example. But, you know, typically speaking, the reason why playing the Doomsayer on an empty board is so great for the Freeze Mage player against Rogue is because Rogue has this wonderful card called Sap that's able to, you know, deal with Doomsayers quite effectively in the middle of your turn when you're trying to set it up to remove minions. So oftentimes the best state to really play it in is just by itself, so it actually buys a turn instead of just getting sapped.
Yep. Not often you see the Frost Nova Doomsayer combo actually go off
against
in this
Rogue,
matchup
yeah.
at all. And both players now have quite the selection of cards. Emperor Thorison is an option, but it would only be hitting Sinister Strike. That's a lot of relevance because this Rogue deck is a Malygos Rogue, of course. So you really want to hit at least one Sinister Strike, maybe an Eviscerate as well, to get those big burst turns down.
Yeah, Pavel had the opportunity there to go off with the Gadgets and Auctioneer if he wanted to. You know, he had Coin, he had Prep, he had Sinister Strike, and he could make something happen there. But I really, really like the patience by him here. Just developing the Tomb Pillager out with the SI this turn fills out the mana curve and enables to get him another coin for Gadgets and Auctioneer. He knows he has plenty of time in this matchup. You know, not a huge amount of time, you know, as it starts approaching, you know, turns 9 and 10 in the mana curve. But he definitely has at least one more turn that he can buy to get a coin. He doesn't have to worry about just overarching board state pressure.
Yeah, and something to just note as well, going back to the Rogue deck that Pavel is using, is because of the Malygos, it wouldn't be exactly the same way that Druid uses it, because Druid has a lot of additional health gain. Mm-hmm. But if Pavel just isn't pressured enough early, he can actually just drop Malygos on the turn.
Sure.
And he doesn't have to kill him. He can just drop it, maybe proc a block, and not worry about Malygos dying, because Freeze Mage just doesn't deal with high health minions very well, hence why Ragnaros is so powerful also.
Yeah, exactly. You know, what will George Seed have to, like, double fireball it?
Yeah, which then you just kind of lose anyway.
How do you win the game then? It's so much harder to collect all the burn necessary to kind of finish out the game. So, the prep, not able to find anything worth prepping. He could prep the Sinister Strike. Oh, he's going to go for it. This likely indicates that he wants to just be dropping Malygos next turn, like you had said.
Yeah, and he's gone straight into the second Sinister Strike as well. So even though he used one, he has another one available, so that's definitely nice for Pavel. He's got so much burst, and you know what? George C., for a Freeze Mage, is relatively low on cards at this point, so it's not like he's close to piecing together the Alexstrasza into finishing combo.
So much burn.
Yeah, well, he has the damage aspect, but no Alexstrasza, and also it's at least an additional turn till Alexstrasza is going to come down anyway.
Yeah, and he's got Blizzard, and he's got Frostbolt if he wants it, or the Ice Lance if he wants it, to maybe try and clean up Gadgets and Auctioneer. Or he could potentially even just ignore the Gadgets and Auctioneer and let the Rogue have cards.
Yeah, do you think you just need Ice Lance to combine it with Frostbolt to actually kill your opponent if you survive that long? Are you going to...
It is a nice option to have. At the moment, the way George's hand is looking is, if he's able to find Emperor Thorsan or if he's able to find Alexstrasza, he wins the game. So he's doubling his outs for ways that he can kind of piece together the damage to burst down his opponent. Because if you count it all up, he's getting pretty close there with the amount of damage he has in his hand.
Yeah, I mean, for 10 mana, he has the damage, right?
Yeah.
To kill him from Alexstrasza. So he does have it available. But this is the turn I half mentioned earlier, where Malygos is just playable versus mage. There's no there versus freeze mage. At least there's no real punish. You're gonna get the spell power, and now we're just gonna see how much value Pavel's gonna get out of this guy. Just have Sinister Strike available, but nothing else. Oh, hang on a minute.
The Servant of Yogg. Yeah, the Servant of Yogg-Saron could cast a spell on
Fireball
the face.
Fireball face.
Could fireball face for 11 damage. So
it could also polymorph his Malygos.
It could also polymorph his Malygos. There's a lot of variables at work there. So some good, some bad.
Big Van Cleef.
Yeah, the 1-1, just massive.
Yeah, this is when you wish you were in Shadow Step.
I'm digging the sap to just get rid of the Accolade of Pain without giving your opponents additional cards, because it's kind of a race against the clock now, because if your opponent's able to play Alexstrasza on you before you pop the block, you're dead.
In trouble. Yeah,
but
yeah.
If you're able to pop the block before they can play Alexstrasza, you win. And you know George C. doesn't have Alexstrasza because he would have just played Alexstrasza last turn and then killed you if he had it. So he's missing some of the pieces to the puzzle still, and you want to try and keep him away from finding them.
Yeah, and just getting the Sinister Strike in there for Pavel, because why not? Mm-hmm. So it can only go face, it's always going face, and you have Malagos on board, as well as the Thanos for an extra plus one. So George C.'s going to cycle and try and just do something to deal with this board, because now even just the minion pressure is actually pretty heavy. Even though it doesn't look too big on the board itself, there's what?
Emperor Thorsan isn't a terrible pickup. If he's able to get an Emperor Thorsan and the Emperor Thorsan proc here isn't bad. It's just not fantastic.
Yeah.
He's reducing a lot of the card draw cards, so he'd be able to more fluidly cycle cards. He also reduces a bunch of cards for the Kobold Geomancer. So, Evolved Kobold. So
I thought you knew the cards, Fiber.
Okay.
I thought you knew all the cards. Come on.
So, if he were to get all of these spells discounted, it would be 3, 4, 5, 6 mana to play it. So he could play all of these spells with the Evolved Kobold if he wanted to.
Yeah, he's just going to go for the torch, start doing the damage. He realizes he does not have the time to try and cycle into Alexstrasza. The block is getting procced next turn.
Yeah, and he doesn't have enough damage quite yet.
It's his assumption anyway. Yeah.
He has 13 damage in hand. If he's able to pick up the Evolved Kobold, he can't actually play all of it with it unless he gets an Emperor discount. So he could go Emperor and Ice Block after his block gets popped, getting an Emperor discount, and then being able to play everything with the Evolved Kobold. Currently, 13 damage. Evolved Kobold would be the same thing as drawing another Fireball, so it only adds, you know, 6 damage to the midst there and bring him up to 19. So the max he can get off of one draw is 19, so he needs to have it like a 2-card combo of things coming together here.
Pyroblast.
There's the Evolved Kobold, so if he's able to find another Fireball, he can make something happen.
What?
Double Servant of Yogg-Saron.
Play them both, Pavel, next turn. That's what you've got to do to win this game, is he actually can't prop the block this turn, which is huge. And George C. deciding to go aggressive, and he's going to be rewarded, as he's going to buy himself enough time to try and make the play to win this game.
Yeah, he's going to be able to cycle more cards and then get the Emperor discount and put up the second Ice Block and then try and go for a big OTK finish.
Yeah, and George C. knows that there's no spells in Pavel's hand that can do any damage, because they just would have been used to prop the block, so he knows. So suddenly, Frost Nova is actually a good play to stop the minion damage, and he might survive another turn without procking the block, which is massive.
Yeah, first off, definitely start with the Accolade of Pain plus the ping. Try and see if you can string something together here and just do all of the card draw possible this turn. And if you're able to get another burn spell, then you've really locked things up for yourself there.
Yeah, so much damage available because of that Evolved Kobold, giving plus 2 spell damage. It's kind of huge. Makes this mage list particularly scary.
So he needs either an Ice Lance, a Frostbolt, a Fireball, a Roaring Torch, or a Forgotten Torch here.
Ice Lance.
Ice Lance, that'll do it. So George C. now, if you count up the damage in his hand, that's an additional 6. So he's got
the Invis coming just too late.
17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25 damage in the hand of George C. after the Emperor discount. So, you know, we talked about how this is kind of a bad matchup and you might need to take some risks. And maybe, you know, for Pavel, if he was
more willing to play the servant.
More willing to play the servant. If he played the servant the previous turn and the servant got a spell that with the Malagos buff popped the block, that would have been one turn faster.
Yep.
And that could have actually been the turn he needed to win the game. What are the odds that he pops the block compared to what are the odds that George C. finds the burn? The odds that George C. finds the burn, pretty high, honestly, at this point. So I think it might have been a risk that would be worth taking. So now George C. just plays Emperor Thorsan plus Ice Block and then has Lethal the following turn.
Yeah, and there's not a lot Pavel can do about it. But he's got 2 chances at Flare.
He does have 2 chances at Flare.
And that's pretty much what you do, right? Like, that's pretty much the play.
It can still happen. The double chances
at Flare. My God. But if this happens, I believe you've got some kind of weird power, even more so than the general caster curse.
Okay.
Because this would be incredible.
It would be definitely absolutely insane, and that would be a blowout way to finish the series with some Servant of Yogg-Saron in Rogue getting Flare.
Yep, they're angry because the boss got nerfed.
You gotta go for it.
Let's see, this is tense.
This is tense.
Go for it, Pavel. Pray.
No, if he pops the block first, he can't get Flare. He needs to play the Servant of Yogg-Saron first in order to get a chance at Flare. Maybe he doesn't think he's dead.
Yeah, he just has the presumption that he's fine. And there's nothing he's... Oh, he could heal with Servant of Yogg-Saron.
Heal
Healing Touch, Holy
well.
Light, for example.
Yeah.
Please play. Oh, right, he's going for it.
If he gets Flare now, though, now it'll look embarrassing. But totally limiting the amount of targets on the field with the backstab there to increase the odds that he heals himself is what he's going for with this line of play by removing the minions there.
Here we go, second one. Mind Vision not going to be enough. Alexstrasza not going to help him this time. And Judge C, it looks like he's pieced together a win in what appeared to be a very, very unfortunate position early on with that Maligos coming down for so long.
Yeah, Pavel just wasn't able to string together any spells and wasn't able to get the job done, wasn't willing to take the risk of the Servant of Yogg-Saron. He felt like he was in a far enough ahead position that he didn't have to take that risk, and kind of misjudged the situation there as George C. was able to string together a way to close out this game.
Yeah, and then we just saw the end of the game finish as George C. does take 1 point on the board there. So he isn't going to be 4-0'd, which is probably the immediate worry to just not get whitewashed in a very important game like this. But it was a crazy game overall. I think, as you said, that Pavel maybe could have been a little bit more risky, especially because he's so far ahead in terms of the series score. But George C. played really well and managed to accumulate enough damage. So pretty crazy. And he gets the one step further on being able to come back in this series. But still going to be an uphill climb for George C., I feel.
Definitely going to be a tough one for George C. to try and close out here. All of his remaining decks are not the greatest against Rogue. So, you know, it's a real tough battle for George C. to climb back in this one. But, you know, George C. is a really great player, and he's pulled off some amazing feats in the past. It wouldn't surprise me if he's able to get the job done.
Yeah, we'll see if he's got what it takes right after this. Welcome back, everyone. We are continuing the series of Pavel versus George C. in the second semi-finals of the day. George C. did just manage to get a win on the board there, as Pavel is 3-1 up currently and still got his Rogue to play, his Maligos Rogue that he was so close with in the last game. But he's going to be versus George C.'s Hunter, Shaman, and Druid, and only has to get a win versus one of them. So George C. has got the Freeze Mage out of the way, but now he's just got to pick any other deck, because he's got to win with all of them versus this Rogue, and we're going straight into it. Of course, Pavel and the Rogue. George C. has chosen the Shaman for this particular game.
Yeah, Shaman, probably his best chance of the remaining decks up against this Rogue deck, so he's just kind of taking the deck he feels has got the highest chance of winning and trying to start this reverse sweep.
Yeah, and how do you feel this matchup really goes? Do you think the Rogue's actually got a really good one here?
I think the Rogue has a really decent chance. It comes down to if you get Tomb Pillager on 4 and if it gets hexed or not a lot of times. Just having the coin to be able to work with your gadgets and Auctioneer and work with your spell power turns and stuff like that is just so crucial. So if the Tomb Pillager comes down on 4 and is able to, you know, transfer itself into a coin, then the Rogue player usually wins from that position. But if there's no Tomb Pillager on turn 4 or the Tomb Pillager gets hexed and there is no coin gained from it, a lot of the times that's enough time, you know, just the Rogue being half a turn behind by not having that coin is enough time for the Shaman to really establish a board that starts becoming too much for the Rogue to handle, because Rogue has some AoE in the form of Fan of Knives, but it's
good
not
timing.
Like before. It's not like before with Blade Flurry. So if the Shaman can just, you know, stomp enough things onto the board and start getting those big thing from below swing turns, they can actually snowball the board enough so that Rogue just can't catch up.
Yeah, and something you touched on there was a play I actually really like, and I believe is just the common go-to, is the Hex onto the Tomb Pillager to just
insane.
Deny the coin. Yeah. It's literally, if you have Hex and they play Tomb Pillager, your turn is played for you. You just
aim
that straight at the Tomb Pillager no matter what.
It's a really important turn. Yeah. It's just, the Rogue deck relies so heavily on the coin to, you know, keep up in pace with the Shaman deck, because Shaman, for the most part, just has superior card quality to the Rogue, but them getting the ability to get an extra card out of the coin with the Gadgets and Auctioneer, and also gain a little bit of extra tempo out of it to make up for the fact that they're investing in a Gadgets and Auctioneer, oftentimes is what allows the Rogue to kind of keep on par with the Shaman tempo.
Yeah, and this is not a bad, you know, plan B to just spell power Lightning Bolt the Tomb Pillager as well. It does give your opponent the coin, but this allows him to develop a Totem Golem behind that, and only overloading for two for the following turn means he can follow up with the Horse Rider as well if needed. And this board is actually getting pretty wide and pretty, you know, pretty scary for Pavel. Actually, he needs to really rush down an option to be able to deal with the, at least a few of these minions, or he'll just take too much damage.
Wow, we see him aggressively going with the Gadgets and Auctioneer here. Would have thought maybe he would go for some sort of, you know, Shiv Shadow Strike play and maybe just kind of wait on it one turn so he would get to be able to cycle the coin as well. But he feels the pressure of these Tunnel Trucks, feels like he needs to react immediately and just start drawing cards there. So
yeah, and double prep allowed him to do that, right? If he only had one prep, he wouldn't have been enough.
So gets in there, gets cycling, and has a lot of decent follow-up to this, you know, a lot of fuel in the tank, but not a lot of removal remaining. So he goes with the Shiv instead of the Sep, probably waited on that decision of the fact that, you know, he's just looking for more spells, more removal to weave in with the development of minions.
Look how minion-heavy the Rogue hand is. It's just all the minions he could want, but definitely needing to get some good use out of that Sap to be able to really get ahead on the board again. And, you know, Feral Spirit is a great card. They're going to go continue to be wide on the board and buff the Tunnel Trog for an easy kill on the Tomb, on the Gadgets, I'm sorry.
And this Emperor Thorsen, he kind of set up for this the previous turn, right? Like, he coined the Gadgets and Auctioneer and then drew a bunch of cards so his hand would be super wide for the Emperor Thorsen to get a ton of value so that he can try and keep up with the Shaman that way. And it looked like it's paying off for him. That Emperor Thorsen hit 7 cards, and it's going to be really tough for George C. to keep up with, as he doesn't have great answer for this Emperor Thorsen either. It's still a 5-5 body that he's got to figure out what does he want to do with.
Yeah, and with that amount of cards being hit, and one of them being Van Cleef. Two mana Van Cleef is awesome.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, you can actually just make a huge Van Cleef the following turn, as well as developing more minions, which is sometimes the problem. If you go big on a Van Cleef, it's normally just the Van Cleef, so then if a Hex comes out, it just hard shuts it down. Mm-hmm. But being able to play even more minions, backstab another great card to be able to start comboing out this turn with. And on the other hand, though, Pavel is on 10 health.
Which is definitely something to consider. Taking some damage because George C. went with the aggressive line. He's like, all right, Pavel's drawn way too many cards with his Auctioneer double prep. I can't keep up with the amount of value he has. So shifting gears here, let's hit him in the face and hopefully we can make it there in time. And at the moment, you know, the amount of removal that Pavel has discounted, it's going to be very tough for George C. to really race him down. And you can see Pavel realizing that this is what George C's game plan was, kind of shifting gears away from the Edwin Van Cleef, going for the pure removal strategy, just trying to avoid any additional face damage whatsoever so he can kind of stay outside the range of just kind of getting cheesed out of this game. And I really like that line of play. I think it's a really smart way to adjust to what your opponent's doing.
Yeah, and the slight frustration here for George C is that the thing from below, which is so commonly played for 0 or 1 mana, it was actually put down for 4, which means that it's sapped back into hand, and now he just doesn't have the time to replay the 4 mana 5-5 Taunt. It's just not going to be good enough. Does get the Drake into the Lightning Storm for a... almost guaranteed clear, but that is actually kind of huge. It's just a free trade into the Drake for Pavel if he really wants. Could use Backstab if he feels like it.
Yeah, definitely going to be using the Backstab. Charge up this Van Cleef. Look at this absolute monster of a power turn. I think you hold on to the SI. Oh my gosh. And we get the...
Backstab him for a million.
Yeah. It is interesting. Do you use the Shiv or do you develop the Tomb Pillager? It's actually really close, right? Like a 5-4 for 2 is really good, and dealing 8 damage for 2 is
Shiv face,
really
Van Cleef.
Yeah.
I like it.
I don't know actually if it's better than the Edwin Van Cleef. Better than the Tomb Pillager.
It feels bad. That's all that matters.
But like,
if you can Shiv face for 8, you do it.
Okay, sure.
Tomb Pillager, you can stay on the bench.
George C, he can stay in this. He's going to need like a Maelstrom Portal top deck after this, but he is able to, you know, clean up a lot of these minions.
And most importantly, Malygos as well. You know, post-hex, like the Malygos does get dropped as well. So the two huge threats on the board getting cleaned up. And the double swashburglar.
Oh, dead.
That is a Wind Fury.
9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 damage.
What? this is twice that the same card been put out, and that's going to be a double Wind Fury turn. And ooh. I'm pretty sure.
It's one damage off.
One damage off.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. That was still scary. That's the second time those Swashburglers have doubled up on the same card, which is kind of ridiculous. Can someone check the card text? Because I'm pretty sure it says a random card every time, not the both Swashburglers are going to pull the same card, and double Wind Fury is kind of nuts.
Thank you.
Oh my god. I need a minute, Firebat. Talk.
Both Lightning Storms are gone, so I have no idea how George C. is going to be able to clear this board with one card off the top. So
he needs his own Swashburglers.
Yeah, he needs a Swashburglar
and
into
that is
going to
be
something.
Off the back of double Wind Fury from Swashburglers, Pavel is going to go into the finals versus RDU in a very convincing 4-1 victory over George C. And that last game, man.
Yeah, that last game, a pretty wild rogue game. Not typically what you see out of it. And, getting that coin out so he could get his gadgets out one turn earlier, which then allowed him to get his Emperor out one turn earlier. And then he was able to fight back one turn faster and stabilize at 10 life. Imagine he doesn't get the coin.
Yep.
And now he's at, four life or whatever, and suddenly you're just always afraid of dying every turn, and the Argent Horse Rider or whatever could have some choice words to kind of close out that game for him. So it's so important there to just have the Tomb Pillager start off the thing, so that you can say, gadgets and double prep so OP, you need that, but it's really all of it together is what makes the whole package come together for the rogue there. But really well played by Pavel, showing like a great mastery over the rogue class. Really fun to watch.
Yeah, really strong performance, and he has booked himself into the finals. But I'm going to go over to a couple of guys who I've no doubt have plenty to say on that series and to prepare you for the finals themselves.
Thanks, guys. I just want to point out that we were sitting over at this table during that match.
I like
and
this story.
As Swashburglar was getting played, before the card was revealed, Dan goes Wind Fury.
Yeah, I looked over at DJ and I was like, I know it's Wind Fury.
The first Wind Fury comes out and he's like, ha, got it, caster vision.
Yeah.
The second one comes out and I just quit.
I actually was staring at my own hands at that point, wondering who gave me this power and why is it given to me?
It's too powerful one, man. But let's go ahead and take a look at the bracket for today to see just how things have shaped out going into the finals. RDU and Pavel have made it all the way. And I know that a lot of people have been saying across the whole day that it's hard to imagine a finals with this group of eight players that is bad. This one is probably one of the best of combinations. RDU has a great story. Pavel, of course, a story of redemption coming from the Europe Championship in 2015.
Yep.
Making that error that cut his run short and now making all the way back to a finals, another chance at a world championship.
Yeah, Pavel was really close last year of qualifying for BlizzCon at the European Championships, and everyone can remember a year back that he made this crazy mistake against a life coach that ended up costing the series, and of course his chance at BlizzCon. A really soul-crushing defeat, if you will. Pavel was really upset because, it was an uncomfortable situation. Come a year later, he is four games away from being able to go to BlizzCon. RDU 2014 had a breakout performance at all these tournaments, acquired all these points that he couldn't even actually go to because Romania was not eligible. This year he is. Both these players want to prove something. Both these players bring the lineups that they're both convinced is going to work. And I love the fact that these guys have their own choices on stuff. RDU loves to bring his own Zoo deck. He has his own style. He loves to bring his own decks. Pavel bringing his own influence of stuff. Who is playing Dark Arakoa in Druid? Who's the one bringing Temple Mage amongst the sea of Freeze Mages? This guy's bringing his own choices of stuff, too. The Temple Mage that we see is uncanny. I really love that Pavel's bringing his own style, and he is an extremely scary player because of just how different he is from everyone else.
And almost every single, a lot of classes being represented in this final as well. I believe seven total classes. We're only missing Paladin and Priest as far as class representation in the final. So we got a lot of diversity going into as well, along with interesting choices, like you mentioned, on current decks. Let's go ahead and talk about Pavel a little bit more, one of our finalists here in his road. One of the top point earners for the season with 70 points from ladder. But he's been sort of quiet as far as the tournament front has gone. No points from majors, very little points from championships.
Yeah, I like to point out that Pavel doesn't really enter many of those big tournaments that you see all the time happening. There's no real DreamHack run that he had or Star Ladder, for example. Instead, he chooses to go through primarily ladder and play in those cups every now and then to keep up the pace. You can see that he's also one of those players that plays a ton of games. Pavel's logged tens of thousands of games, and that's that's partially what makes him really scary, is because he's one of those players that's played so much Hearthstone, and he understands what makes every deck tick. The scariest players, in my opinion, are ones that are not known for specific deck, because they're the ones that you know that can play everything. They're Swiss Army knives. And what makes Pavel, in my opinion, the complete threat is that he's also willing to extend beyond the norm. He has these interesting cards that you don't really expect to play, and so as a result, you have to account for him differently from other players because he makes all these tech choices that people wouldn't play in normal tournaments.
Yeah, and you know, speaking of his road to get to this finals and just this tournament alone, having one of the toughest roads out of any player here, having to defeat Hoi and George C, as you saw in that last matchup, which are two of the most well-respected players in all of Europe right now. George C because of his performances this year across the Hearthstone Championship Tour, Hoi because of his performances, you know, in the past few years with many top six, top four finishes in a lot of major tournaments. So Pavel definitely proving himself so far today. Is there a weak link? Is there a deck that maybe RDU can pressure? What are we looking for as far as his performance going to the finals?
It's tricky because Tempo Mage is one of those decks you live and die by. You have some players who just think it's not good. It's just, in their words, it's trash because it feels like it's so inconsistent based off its openings. Your win percentages vary so much based off your opening hand. And even just having the coin can influence so much the decisions of the series and outcomes. Not to mention that he also has a very different list. He has two Firelands Portals and two Arcane Anomalies. No one really plays that. And he also has strict Yogg's run from his deck because of the recent change in patches. There's a lot of things that really come into Pavel's lineup that are big question marks, but it's gotten him this far, and you have to kind of admit, it's actually really cool that someone's able to still innovate, whether how big or how small, depends on the viewer's perspective. You've gotten him this far to the finals.
Yeah, I mean, we'll look at even Dr. Hippie throughout his road to the Summer Championship had Temple Mage, his lineup, a player that brought Freeze Mage forever. Pavel also a player that's been known to play some Freeze Mage, but like you said, Swiss Army Knife of Hearthstone.
Yeah.
You can play anything. Freeze Mage was just that little swirly thing that comes off the end.
And I love that Pavel's also part of the Russian community. I know it's not something he's in control of because it is his heritage, but the fact that the Russian community doesn't get enough representation in general, they're a very strong group of players. They all represent a huge portion of the European scene. If you just look at ladder and look at the top 100 finishes, there's many Russian players. They're very good at Hearthstone, but just because they don't speak English and connect to the rest of the West, you can see that the community is growing a lot. They're playing a lot of games. They have their own celebrities in their own right. Look at guys like Silvername and some of these other Russian players really rising up through the ranks. It doesn't surprise me that Pavel's been able to go through all the process once again and come one step away from qualifying for BlizzCon. And what a story again it would be to come back the following year after coming back from that terrible mistake. And imagine if he was able to go even further than BlizzCon.
It would be the ultimate redemption for him. But we have some friends across the studio that might have some.